In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
I hope that what I have studied with you is intensely interesting to you today. I hope it's as interesting to you as it has been to me to study it. But before we open God's Word to study, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the Bible. We thank you for your Word, and we thank you for the promises in your Word, and we pray that you'll help us to be the people that live by every word that proceeds out of your mouth. And we pray that by your grace and power, that your Holy Spirit will open the eyes of our understanding now so that we will understand what you're trying to teach us. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to begin today by telling you a story from Christian tradition. All of you know, and what I'm telling you at the first part is not tradition, we all know that the Apostle John was the only one of the 12 apostles to not die a violent death. And the only reason that he was not martyred was because God didn't allow it. Because they took him and they filled a cauldron full of boiling oil and they put him in it to kill him. But God would not allow him to be killed because the book of Revelation was not written yet. God knew exactly what he had in mind. The book of Revelation was not written yet. The Bible was not completely written yet. And so when they put John in this cauldron of boiling oil, nothing happened. They watched and they watched, and there he was in the cauldron of boiling oil, and nothing happened. So after a while, they lifted the same person that put him in, lifted him out. And then the emperor, Domitian, was extremely angry, furious. He, what are we going to do? We can't kill this man. And so they decided, since we can't kill him, we'll still get rid of him. We'll banish him to the Isle of Patmos, which they did. And when he was banished there, they thought that that was the end. Nobody will hear anything more about from him again. And I suppose the Apostle John thought that that was his end too. He probably thought that he would never again live, and he would probably die there. But the emperor was removed, and there was a new emperor of the Roman Empire, and the new emperor decided to, of all of these people that had been banished, and he decided to set them free. So John was set free, and he went back to Ephesus. Now, what I'm going to tell you now, we know that he lived to be very, very old, but this is this is Christian tradition. I'm not telling you as though this is the gospel truth. I don't know. But this is Christian tradition, that the Apostle John became so old that he could not preach a normal length discourse on the Sabbath. And according to tradition, Christian tradition, there came a time when he preached his last sermon. Evidently a very short sermon. And according to tradition, in this last sermon that he preached, this is what he said. I will tell you the whole sermon right now. He said, "Little children, love one another." And then he repeated it. "Little children, love one another. Little children, love one another." And according to tradition, after he had said that many times, the audience began to remonstrate with him. Instead of preaching us a sermon, you're just saying this over and over. And when they began to remonstrate with him, according to tradition, this is what he replied. He says, "That is the whole substance of Christianity." We don't know for sure if that's exactly what happened, because that's just a traditional story. But I want you to open your Bible now and look in the Gospel of John, the 13th chapter, verses 33 and 34. Now, this is not tradition. This is the Word of God. And this is what it says in John 13, 34, 33 and 34. This is the night Jesus was betrayed. He said, "Little children, I shall be with you a little while longer. You will seek me, and as I said to the Jews, where I am going, you cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." If you know that, you know everything you need to know to be saved. But if we would work ill to those for whom Christ has paid the infinite price of his life, then we do not have the fruit of sanctification in our character. We read in our scripture this morning that the only people that are going to be inside the holy city, did you notice the only people that will be inside the holy city? We read Revelation 21, 22 to 27. The only people that will be inside are who? Did you notice it? It told us who wouldn't be on the inside, but it also said who would be on the inside. Only the people that what? I think I heard somebody say it. It's in the last verse we read, right at the very end of the chapter. The only people that will be inside the holy city are which people? Thank you. Somebody learned it. It's the people whose names are in the Lamb's Book of Life. Those are the only people that will be. By the way, it's just a casual reading of the last three chapters of the Bible, Revelation 20, 21, and 22, would convince any candid reader that those are the only people that are going to be inside. Revelation 20 says that everybody else is going to be outside. So, if that's the case, it's very important for you and for me to have our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So I want to ask you a question. Right now, is your name in the Lamb's Book of Life? If your name is not in the Lamb's Book of Life right now, would you like to get it in there? How can you have assurance that your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life? How can you have assurance that your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life? Now I'm going to read to you a statement from the book This Day with God, page 87. And I know before I read this that there will probably be somebody hearing this somewhere sometime that will think, oh, you're a legalist. And that's fine if you want to think that way. But this statement will, I hope, focus your mind on something that's essential if your name is going to be in the Lamb's Book of Life. Jesus made the statement in Matthew 7:21-23, that there would be many people who would call him Lord, Lord, and they would think that they were saved, and they would come right up to the day of judgment, and they would find out that they are lost, and he would say to them, "I never knew you. Depart from me, you that practice lawlessness." That's in Matthew 7:21-23. So there, it is the same thing that we're going to read is stated in the negative. The person who practices lawlessness, their name is not in the Book of Life. They're going to be lost. We need to face that. The person who practices lawlessness, their name is not in the Book of Life, and they're going to be lost. However, probation hasn't closed yet. Your destiny could be changed. Here's the statement on the sentence. This is stating in the positive the same thing that Jesus stated in the negative in Matthew 7, 21 to 23. Obedience to God's commands will enroll our names in the Lamb's Book of Life. Not complicated, is it? However, there are some things that are simple that are difficult or even impossible. And when you read something like that, oftentimes there's somebody in their mind, they say, yes, that's the problem. I would like to, but I can't. Well, of course you can't. You and I... You listening? You and I have a sinful, fallen human nature, and we cannot obey God's commands unless we have supernatural help. Does the Bible teach that? Many, many places in the Bible that is taught. But rather than go to the text and show you that the Bible teaches that we cannot obey God's commands unless we have supernatural help, let's just look at the areas that show us how, where, and how to get the supernatural help. Look in your Bible, in the book of Galatians. Now this will give you a clue right away what kind of help we need. Galatians 5. By the way, have you ever met somebody who has said to you, well, I'm not under the law. You're under the law, but I'm not. Have you ever met somebody like that? I'm not under the law. My experience so far in life has been 100% of the people that I have met that have told me that they're not under the law are under the law. They're terribly mistaken, but we won't go into that. But this text shows you how not to be under the law. Here it is. Galatians 5. Starting with verse 16. Walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit. The flesh is your fallen, sinful human nature. That's what the flesh is. Your fallen, sinful human nature. He says, for the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. If you're led by the Spirit, what? You're not under the law. The only people in the world who are not under the law are the people that are led by the Spirit. Do you know why that's true? Well, let's just read a few more verses, see if we can figure out something. Now, the works of the flesh are evident. This is what happens when a person just does what's natural. You're just doing what comes naturally. This is what will happen. The works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. There are many people today that are living according to the flesh, and they say, we're not under the law, but they are deluded. They are under the law. They're doing these works of the flesh. They're under the law, and they are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Is that what the Scripture says? That's what the Scripture says. The only people that are not under the law are the people who are led by the Spirit. That's what he says. Why is that? Well, let's just read it. Go to the book of Romans, the 8th chapter. Romans 8. Verse 1 says, there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Look at verse 4. That the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Notice, the person who is led by the Holy Spirit, the person who is walking according to the Spirit, that person's sins have been forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ that he poured out on Calvary, but they're not sinning anymore. They are keeping the law. That's why they're not under it. Their past sins have been forgiven, and at the present time, they're walking in the Spirit, and they are keeping the law. Notice what it says in verse 4, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. The person that's walking according to the Spirit, the righteous requirement of the law is fulfilled in that person's life. So they're not under the law. Their past sins have been forgiven, and they're living in harmony with the law, so they're not under it. Everybody else in the world is under the law. The Bible says that. Turn to Romans 3, verse 19. It says, now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. How many people in the world are under the law? The whole world. Except those who have accepted Jesus as their Savior and have received the Holy Spirit, and they're being led by the Spirit, and the righteous requirement of the law is being fulfilled in their life. They're living according to the law. And so they're the only people in the world that are not under it. And when the apostle wrote these things, the only people that had those qualifications were the people that were in the Christian church. And interestingly, we read in our scripture from Revelation 21, 22 to 27. And if you read the last four chapters of the Bible, Revelation 19, 20, 21, and 22, you will see very clearly in those chapters, I hope, especially in chapter 19, that when Jesus comes back to this world, let me preface that by saying that when Jesus came to the world the first time, the first advent of Christ, 2,000 years ago, when Jesus came to the world the first time, he did not come to judge the world, he came to save the world. That's what he said to Nicodemus. He came to save the world. He came as the Savior. But when he comes a second time, he's coming for a completely different purpose. When he comes a second time, he is coming to judge the world. And because of the wickedness of the world, the Bible says in both the Old and New Testament that when he comes a second time, that he's going to destroy the world. And the only people that will not get destroyed are those that belong to his church. Jesus is coming back to this world to destroy the world for its wickedness, but to take his church out of the world to a different place. Now, if you understand that, then does it seem to be of critical importance to you that you be a member of God's church? It does to me. And somewhat over 20 years ago, when I was disfellowshipped from the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which formerly, before that time, I'd been an ordained minister for that church, people wrote me letters. And they were distressed, as though, you know, you're going to be lost. I said, well, what are you talking about? The reason they were distressed was because they did not understand who and what the church is. In fact, this has happened all over the world. Some years ago, Pastor Rafael Perez was preaching down in South America. I should be careful. It might have been Central America, but I think it was South America. As you know, Pastor Domingo Nunez and Pastor Rafael Perez can speak fluent Spanish. Now, I had Spanish for a couple of years in school, but I've never used it, so I can't speak it at all. But Pastor Perez can speak Spanish, and he was down there, and a Seventh-day Adventist lady came to him weeping, crying. Well, why are you weeping? Why are you crying? Well, because I was told that if I attended your meeting, I would be disfellowshipped. And then, of course, she thought she would be lost. Now, this idea has been intentionally perpetrated all over the world. And by the way, it did not start with the Seventh-day Adventist. This idea started, well, we better be careful where we say it started, but it has existed for 1,000 years or more in the Roman Catholic Church. If you have studied theology, maybe there's a few of you here that have studied historical theology, and many hundreds of years ago, there were official papal bulls that declared that in order to be saved in the kingdom of heaven, you had to be a member of the Roman Catholic Church. I wondered sometimes how many million people decided that they better stay in the Roman Catholic Church because of those pronouncements that were made. But the Roman Catholics actually didn't start it. Way before that, in Jesus' time, the Jews had a tradition, and their belief was that you had to be a member of the Jewish church to be saved. I want to read to you something interesting in the Bible about that. Look in your Bible in John, the 9th chapter. Now, this is the story in John, the 9th chapter. It's a very interesting story about the man that was born blind, and Jesus healed him and gave him his eyesight, and he did it on the Sabbath, and he intentionally did it on the Sabbath. And so the Jews were starting to ask some questions. And notice what they did to his parents. They called the parents of this boy. Look at verse 18 starting. The Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been blind and received his sight until they called the parents of him who had received his sight. And they asked them, saying, "Who is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered them and said, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but by what means he now sees, we do not know. Or who opened his eyes, we do not know. He is of age, ask him, he will speak for himself." His parents said these things because why? They feared the Jews. Well, why did they fear the Jews? For the Jews had agreed already that if anyone confessed that he was Christ, he would be put out of the synagogue. That's why his parents said that. Ask him, don't ask us. They told a lie. They knew exactly who had opened their son's eyes. Everybody in town knew about this. This was going like wildfire all over town. They knew exactly who had opened their son's eyes. But they told a lie. They said, "We don't know who did it." That was a lie. Now I want to read you something interesting from the book of Revelation. We already read it in our scripture reading. Look in Revelation 21:27. I want you to see what it says about people that tell lies. We read it already in Revelation 21:27. What does it say in Revelation 21:27 about people that tell lies? They will not be in the kingdom of heaven. Now, think this through. They told a lie because they had been taught that if they were disfellowship in the Jewish church, they would be lost. So in order to not be disfellowship, they guaranteed their damnation unless they repented. They told a lie. And the Bible says very clearly that if you're a liar, you will not be in the kingdom of heaven. It says that, by the way, three times in the last two chapters of the Bible. Three times you're told that no liar will be there. How come they told a lie? Because they had been taught that if you did not belong to this church organization, you would be lost. And so they were willing to tell a lie and guarantee their damnation in order to stay in that church organization. Well, so this idea that you have to be in a certain church organization, whether it's the Seventh-day Adventist or the Roman Catholic or the Jewish or whatever it is, that is a very, very old idea. In fact, even Jesus' disciples had that idea, only they had a little bit different twist on it. They believed that Jesus Christ and they were the true church, not the Jews, and so you had to belong to them. You had to belong to their church organization. Let's read about that in the Bible. That's what we're talking about, if you study theology, what we're talking about is sectarianism. I'm sorry, I can see I'm not going to get done. We'll just go as fast as we can, do as much as we can. Maybe I'll have to finish this tonight. I was planning to preach on something else tonight, but we'll see. Look in Mark, the 9th chapter. Starting with verse 38. Now John answered him, saying, "Teacher, we saw someone who does not follow us, casting out demons in your name." Now remember, the Roman Catholic Church has made a big point of the fact that a church needs to be apostolic. Now let me ask you this question. Was this an apostolic church? This was the apostolic church. This was the 12 apostles and Jesus himself in person. This was the apostolic church. I don't see how anybody can dispute that. This was the apostolic church. This were the 12 apostles and Jesus Christ himself in person. And so John says, "Teacher, we saw someone who does not follow us." In other words, they did not belong to their church organization. "Casting out demons in your name, and we forbade him because he does not follow us." He is not part of our group. He's not part of our organization. So we told him to quit. Notice what Jesus said. But Jesus said, "Do not forbid him. For no one who works a miracle in my name can soon afterwards speak evil of me. For he who is not against us is on our side." He who is not against us is on our side. So, as a result of these teachings of Jesus, there developed what I call the professed Christian church. And we'll read what the Bible says about it in just a moment. That's a biblical concept. And what is the professed Christian church? It's the church that professes to be the church of Jesus Christ, the true church. Now, in the world in which we live, every church that professes to be the church of Jesus Christ is not really the true church. Would that make sense to you? But they make that profession. So, if you make the profession that you're the church, that you're the true church, then you're part of the professed church. Now, there are people in Wichita that don't make any profession. They're not part of it. They don't make any profession. And by the way, we are not at all saying that those of us that make a profession are saved and those people that aren't making a profession are lost. We're not making any judgments about who's saved and lost. We're just saying those that make a profession They are the professed Christian church. Now, this arises from biblical usage. Turn in your Bible to 2 Timothy. Maybe, before I read that, I should read to you 1 Timothy 3:15, so it'll be easier for you to see the context. 1 Timothy 3:15. It says in 1 Timothy 3:15, "But if I am delayed, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth." The church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth, is called the house of God. Does that make sense? That's what he says. And my dear friends, this professed church is a great house. Let's read that. Look in 2 Timothy 2, verse 20 and 21. It says, "But in a great house," what's the great house? It's the professed church. "In a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor." There's all kinds. "Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work." So, in a great house, in the professed church, there is both vessels that are honorable, vessels that are dishonorable. The vessels that are dishonorable, by the way, someday will burn up. You can read that in 1 Corinthians, so we won't go there now. But look at what it says in verse 19. 2 Timothy 2:19. "Nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal: the Lord knows those who are His. And let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity." Who are the people that name the name of Christ? That's the professed church. They make a profession of being Christian. They make a profession of being the church of God. They name the name of Christ. Paul says, if you do that, be sure that you depart from all iniquity. What if I don't? Well, that's been the problem with the professed church for thousands of years. And that's a problem with the Adventist church. Many years ago, in Ellen White's day, there was a missionary in a Sunday-keeping church, and she was a missionary in Africa. And from her Bible study, she became convicted of the truth of the Sabbath and the three angels' messages. And she became a Seventh-day Adventist. And as a result of that, she could not stay in Africa working as a missionary for that church. She couldn't stay there. She was a person who had excellent ability as a teacher of children and also as a counselor for mothers of young children. And this woman came to Battle Creek. Now, this is a long story, and I don't have time to tell you the long story. Suffice it to say, she was not treated very well in Battle Creek, and as a long-term consequence of that is she died. And Ellen White gave some very stern rebukes to the Battle Creek Church for what they did in regard to this woman. I want to read you just a sentence or two. This is what she wrote. She said, "Even the professed Church of Christ." Who's she talking to? She's talking to the Battle Creek Church. She refers to them as the professed Church of Christ. "Even the professed Church of Christ, with their exalted privileges and high professions, discerned not the image of Christ in this self-denying child of God, because they were so far removed from Christ themselves that they reflected not His image." So she refers to the Battle Creek Church as the professed church. We're part of the professed church too. We make the same profession that they made in Battle Creek. We profess to believe the same doctrines and teachings. So we're part of the professed church too. And when you say to the Lord, "Lord, I am dedicating myself totally to You. I'm choosing to come totally under the sovereignty of Jesus Christ." Are you listening? God takes you at your word. I am a slow learner, I guess, but I am learning slowly. I wish I'd have known it as well as I knew it now, 40 or 50 years ago. But God takes people at their word. In the parable, Jesus said to the unfaithful servant, he says, I'll judge you out of your own mouth. After David sinned and Nathan the prophet came to him and told him the story and he got angry and pronounced judgment, that judgment that he pronounced was the judgment he received. He was judged out of his own mouth. God takes you at your word. And if you make a profession and you say, Lord, I'm surrendering my life to you. I'm choosing to follow you. I'm choosing to accept the sovereignty of Jesus Christ in my life. I'm not going to be my own boss anymore. I want just to be a disciple of Jesus Christ and do whatever he says and not do whatever he says not to do. God takes you at your word. And your name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. But for your name to remain in the Lamb's Book of Life, your life has to come into harmony with your profession. Does that make sense? Let's be sure we understand that. Does it make sense to you for God to require that my life be the same as what I profess? If my life is not the same as what I profess, what am I? I'm a living lie. That's why it says in Revelation 3:5, look at Revelation 3:5. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. So, if I choose to yield my life to the sovereignty of Jesus Christ, you know what the word sovereignty means? In other words, he's my Lord. I'll do what he says. If I choose that, and I tell the Lord that, the Lord will take me at my word. At my profession of faith, the Lord will accept me on the basis of my profession of faith. And the Holy Spirit then starts to work in my life. And here's what happens. I'm going to make it as simple as I know how. As soon as that happens, I know this from my own experience. I know it's so. The Holy Spirit starts to lead me. And as the Holy Spirit starts to lead me, the Holy Spirit puts his finger on something. John, how about this? You know that's wrong. Well, I say, okay, Lord, I understand. That's not pleasing to the Lord Jesus Christ, so that I won't have that be part of, by your grace, I won't have that be part of my life anymore. And if I make that decision, then the Holy Spirit keeps leading me onward. And the Holy Spirit leads me on a little more, and boom. Holy Spirit puts his finger on and says, John, how about this? Look at that. Yes, Lord. You're right. I know that. I know from my reading of the Bible, that's not according to what the Lord wants me to be in my life. So, Lord, I will leave that go. I want to follow Jesus, and so I will leave that go so that I can follow. And then, if I do that, then the Holy Spirit leads me another step. And at every step, the Holy Spirit puts his finger on something in my life. And says, "What about this? What about this? What about this?" Now let me ask you a question. What if I come to the point and the Holy Spirit puts his finger on something and says, John, what about this? And I say, Lord, I'm not going to give that up. This is where. What happens then? Then I just stop right there. By the way, let's read what Jesus said about that. About people that stopped And Jesus encouraged us not to stop. Let's read that. Look in your Bible in John 12. John 12. Starting with verse 35. Then Jesus said to them, "A little while longer the light is with you. Walk while you have the light." What did Jesus say to do while you have the light? To walk. What does it mean to walk? It means to make progress. Doesn't it? If I'm walking, I'm not standing still. I'm making progress. And when the Holy Spirit points out something, when the light shines on something, I say, "Yes, Lord, I'm going to come into harmony with that. Yes, Lord, I'm going to come into harmony with that." And then I'm walking. I'm walking in harmony with the light. And as the light moves and I see more and more things, my life comes more and more and more into harmony with the perfect will of God. Isn't that what we want as Christians? That's what Jesus is talking about. He says, while you have the light, walk. Walk in it. Don't stand still. Walk in it. Lest darkness overtake you. What does that mean? That means, my friends, that the light is moving. And if I'm not walking, the light will leave me. He who walks in darkness does not know where he's going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of the light. These things Jesus spoke and departed and was hidden from them. Now, I'm going to read to you. We are marvelously blessed as God's professed people today. Just my heart overflows when I think of the way that God has blessed the Second Advent movement by giving us the Spirit of Prophecy. And the Spirit of Prophecy, the Holy Spirit puts His finger right on these Bible teachings that we've just been going over and explains it in simple language that a child can understand. And so what we just studied, I'm going to read to you a statement from volume 1, page about 186, 187, where what we just studied will be explained in such simple language that I hope a child can understand it. Now listen carefully. God leads His people on step by step. Now is that what we've been talking about? Step by step. The Holy Spirit puts His finger on it. John, how about this in your life? What about this in your life? So if I accept that, then I'm walking in the light. She says, God leads His people on step by step. God does not expect you to jump a half a mile away. He just wants you to take the next step. Can you do that? God leads His people on step by step. He brings them up to different points calculated to manifest what is in the heart. God brings me up to a point to it so it be, I see what's really in my heart. I didn't know before, but now I do. Some endure at one point but fall off at the next. So I endure at this point, some people endure at this point, but then they come to the next point, they don't go there. They're not willing to take that one, not willing to take that step. By the way, just as an aside, do you know that there are people in their Christian experience who have been stalled for years? And the Holy Spirit maybe has talked to them thousands of times. And so it doesn't even bother them anymore. Going to take this step? No, Lord. If you do that, the Holy Spirit will let you do that. And you're lost. My dear friend, don't allow yourself to get into a situation where the Holy Spirit can point out something in your life that needs to change and you say, no, no. Don't allow yourself. Don't think it's not important. It has to do with whether you're going to be saved or lost.
It's not the magnitude of it. It's not the magnitude, it's the attitude. God can't save somebody with that kind of an attitude. God cannot save somebody that he shows them something, they don't listen. Oh, it's just a little thing, but they won't listen. I was reading just, I think it was last night. Ellen White said, Eve didn't think it was a very big thing when she ate the forbidden fruit. She didn't think that was a big deal. Just eating a piece of fruit. God leads his people on step by step. He brings them up to different points calculated to manifest what is in the heart. Some endure at one point but fall off at the next. At every advanced point, the heart is tested and tried a little closer. Have you had that experience? Have you been following the Lord and said, "Woo! I didn't know about that. At every advanced point, the heart is tested and tried a little closer. And then she says, if the professed people of God, who's the professed people of God? That's the professed church. That's the people that claim to be God's people. That's you and me if we're Christians. If we belong to a church, if we belong to a Christian church, if we belong to a remnant church, an Adventist church, that's us. We're the professed people of God. If the professed people of God find their hearts opposed to this straight work, it should convince them that they have a work to do to overcome if they would not be spewed out of the mouth of the Lord. You all know that scripture. That's in Revelation, the 3rd chapter, where Jesus says to the Laodicean church, he said, listen, I'll just put it in common language. If there's not a change in you, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Here's what the angel said. God will bring his work closer and closer to test and prove every one of his people. Some are willing to receive one point, but when God brings them to another testing point, they shrink from it and stand back because they find that it strikes directly at some cherished idol. Now, different people worship different idols. Does that make sense to you? We don't all have the same problem with the same idol. With different people, it's different. But tell you this. God knows exactly what your trouble spot is in your Christian experience, and God knows exactly what my trouble spot is in my Christian experience. And whatever it is, doesn't matter what it is, whatever the weak point is in my Christian experience, the Lord's going to bring me right to that point, and the Holy Spirit's going to put his finger right on that. And then I have to make a decision. You still going to keep walking? Or are you getting stalled in your Christian experience? And I want to repeat again so that nobody misunderstands. There are people, there are Christians, there are Adventists who have been stalled in their Christian experience for years. They've come up to a certain point and they won't go any further. And they're going to be lost. Unless they repent and decide they're going to go all the way. One of the texts that impressed itself upon my mind a great deal when I was a teenager, it was one of the hardest texts in the Bible for me. It's in Luke 14, about 33. Jesus said, except a man forsake all that he has, he cannot be my disciple. And when I first understood that, I thought, ooh, what in the world am I going to do? That's a battle. Are you going to go all the way with the Lord? Do you really want to go to... Are you serious about going to the kingdom of heaven? Are you willing to give up what's in this world to get there? She says, Here they have opportunity to see what is in their hearts that shuts out Jesus. They prize something higher than the truth, and their hearts are not prepared to receive Jesus. Individuals are tested and proved a length of time to see if they will sacrifice their idols and heed the counsel of the true witness. They're tested. My dear friend, you and I are in the testing time right now. We're tested. Are you willing to give up these idols? Sometimes I have given lists of some of the common idols that people worship and serve today, but I'm not going to do that. I think that if the Holy Spirit is here and speaking to your heart, the Holy Spirit right now can put his finger exactly what the problem is that's keeping you from taking the next step. You know what it is, and the Holy Spirit knows what it is. I don't need to know. But do you want to keep walking with the Lord, or are you going to allow your experience to be stalled? Maybe you've already been stalled for a while. Would you like to start walking with the Lord again and not be in a stalled Christian experience that will guarantee your condemnation in the day of judgment? She says, individuals are tested and proved a length of time to see if they will sacrifice their idols and heed the counsel of the true witness. If any will not be purified through obeying the truth. That, by the way, is a direct quote right out of 1 Peter 1, verse 22. You're purified, not because you know the truth. There's people all over Wichita. I've met lots of them. I've studied the Bible with them. And they know the truth and they believe it. But they're not on the way to the kingdom of heaven because they're not obeying the truth. Your soul is only purified if you obey the truth. It's not purified just because you know it. If any will not be purified through obeying the truth and overcome their selfishness, their pride, and evil passions, the angels of God have the charge. They are joined to their idols. Let them alone. Now that's a really scary statement because that's a direct quotation too, right out of Hosea. It was a judgment that was pronounced on the tribe of Ephraim. And the Lord said concerning the tribe of Ephraim, they are joined to their idols. Let them alone. Well, guess what? If you go to the book of Revelation, in Revelation the 7th chapter, and read down through the 12 tribes who make up the 144,000, you will find that the tribe of Ephraim is not there. They were joined to their idols. The Lord said, let them be. The tribe of Ephraim, as a tribe, committed the unpardonable sin. They're not. The tribe of Ephraim is not part of the 144,000. If any will not be purified through obeying the truth and overcome their selfishness, their pride, and evil passions, the angels of God have the charge. They are joined to their idols, let them alone, and they pass on to their work, leaving these with their sinful traits unsubdued to the control of evil angels. My dear friends, I pray about this, and I say, Lord, I do not want to come under the control of evil spirits or evil angels. Do you want to come under their control? The only way to guarantee that you'll never come under their control is to keep walking in the light. When the Holy Spirit points out something, you say, yes, Lord, I will give that up. I'll change. Those who come up to every point and stand every test and overcome, be the price what it may, have heeded the counsel of the true witness. That's the true witness in Revelation 3, 14 to 21. And they will receive the latter rain and thus be fitted for translation. Interesting. If I'm willing to keep walking, where's the Lord going to take me? The Lord's going to take me into a latter rain experience, which will result in translation. Is that the kind of a destiny that it appears desirable to you? Well, if it is, friend, don't ever forget what we studied today. The light's moving. I have to keep walking with it. Let's pray before we sing our closing song. Father in heaven, we thank you for Jesus our Savior and that he has made a way of escape so that every human being in this world can be delivered from this place and be taken to a place where we are given everlasting life and we are allowed the privilege again to have open conversation with our Maker. And we earnestly pray that you'll help us to realize what's really involved in the Christian walk. And Lord, if we have stalled, help us to realize what we're really doing. Help us not to stand still and thereby commit the unpardonable sin. We pray that you'll help us to walk while we have the light, that our profession may not be in vain. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.